study in the book of Joshua. And as I said when I gave the introduction to the historical books in general, Joshua is the first book in a group that in the Hebrew Bible are referred to as the former prophets, mostly what we call the historical books. In the Hebrew Bible, it's called the former prophets, and the books that we would call prophets, they call the latter prophets. That's just how they've come to designate them. The theme of this book is the fulfillment of God's promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the Israelites at a later date as well, when he reaffirmed the promises that he would give them the land of Canaan. The inheritance of the land of Canaan was extremely important to Israel, their history, and obviously it's important to the people of Israel even now. Whether it's biblically significant now is questionable, but the issue is, you know, the Jewish people have always been a people who are called to be apart. At least in biblical times, they were called to be apart from the nations of people of God. Since biblical times, they've been kind of kept apart from others by their culture, which was developed during those years when they were people of God, and they are culturally different in many respects than the Gentiles. That's not true, of course, of all Jews, because the Jews have integrated into all types of society and culture, and many Jews don't even identify themselves with Jewish culture or Jewish religion anymore. But nonetheless, because of their cultural isolation, I suppose it's because of that, it's because of other things too, they have been persecuted in most of the lands where they've lived. And when they don't have a homeland of their own, obviously they're subject to the persecution from the governing authorities where they live. God intended for them from the beginning to have a land of their own, a piece of property that they could govern according to the ways of God in the midst of a world that's run by pagans. You know, it's the settlers in this country originally kind of felt that they were doing something similar. I don't see it as much of a parallel as some people do, but it was nonetheless the case that Christian people persecuted for some of their views in Europe once at least had the option of going to a foreign land across the ocean that was pretty much available. I guess the Native Americans might question whether it was available or not, but I mean, there's enough room for them anyway, and there was no government there to restrict them from setting up their own. And so there was some place to go where they could be separate and live by their principles, and that's what Israel needed. They needed a land to live by their principles at. I often have reflected on what a sad thing it is that in our time, there are no more places. There aren't any places to go. You know, if the government goes corrupt and persecutes Christians here, you know, for the last couple of centuries, people have come here to get away from that. And if you want to get away from here to get away from that, where do you go? Well, the planet's pretty much covered now with governments, and it's not like it was. But even the land that Israel took over was inhabited and had governments. They had to conquer it. Now, this is one of the most objectionable things to modern sentiments in the in the Old Testament. And many people think the book of Joshua is very offensive because, obviously, they went in and committed genocide of the Canaanites. And we do have to understand what was going on there because the Bible indicates they were commanded by God to do this, and yet the God of the Bible identifies himself as a just and merciful God who loves the world and all kinds of things like it. In fact, who's like Jesus. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So the whole idea of going in and wiping out human populations from certain areas is something that troubles Christians and non-Christians and needs to be understood in its proper context. And we will certainly give, I hope, sufficient attention to that question. But we can begin by demonstrating that the purpose of the book of Joshua, or its main theme, is that God fulfilled his promises in giving them a land to call their own. In chapter 21, this is pretty much the statement of the theme of how of what was accomplished in this book. The last verses of chapter 21, verse 43 through 45, it says, so the Lord... And by the way, we're at the very beginning of this school. Some of you know this and some of you knew it without coming to our previous schools, and some of you have been to our previous schools, but for those of you who don't know this, the word Lord, when it is as it is here in all capital letters, the translators, by putting the word Lord in all capital letters, are informing you that in the Hebrew, what stands there in the place of the word Lord is what they call the tetragram, or the tetragrammaton, which is four Hebrew consonants. They can be rendered YHVH or YHWH or J. See, the Y and the J are kind of interchangeable, and the V and the W are kind of interchangeable. So you can have V, J and V, or Y and W. So it's YHWH or JHVH can be an alternative. And when you add certain vowels to these, this word can be pronounced Yahweh or Jehovah or differently still. There is dispute among scholars as to what its correct pronunciation is, but the whole idea seems to be that it wasn't really something that was made to be pronounced because there's no vowels in it. You can't really pronounce a word that doesn't have vowels. On the other hand, the Hebrew text of the Old Testament was entirely without vowels anyway, and the vowels were implied. It wasn't until after the time of Christ that the Masoretic scribes, Jews, added vowel points to what's called the Masoretic text, which is the Hebrew text we use for the Old Testament, so that it could be, you know, I don't know where they how they decided which vowels go there, but the point is, this name, YHWH, which we could, for convenience, call Yahweh, but which the King James Version, for convenience, called Jehovah. Doesn't matter. They're the same name, just pronounced, vocalized differently. The vocalization, I think, is not what's important, although there are a group of people called the Sacred Name Movement who think it's all important that we call God by his right name and pronounce the name of Yeshua instead of Jesus and so forth. That's a side issue. In my opinion, the pronunciation is not the issue. But where you find the word Lord in all capital letters, it is that name. Now, when you find the word Lord and it's not all capital letters in the Old Testament, when it's just L-O-R-D without the capitals, then it's a different word. It's the word Adonai. Okay, so when we're reading the book of Joshua or any of the Old Testament books, we're going to encounter the word Lord, sometimes in all caps, sometimes not in all caps. When it's in all caps, it's Yahweh. When it's not, it's Adonai. Now, Adonai is just a generic term for master or lord or even sir. The term is sometimes used in addressing men with respect. You call them Adonai. So God is sometimes called Adonai, just like a master of a servant would be called, just like you might call him master. But Yahweh is more of a proper name for God. It's the name that God revealed to Moses at the burning bush. And it's the special name by which Israel identified their God from all other gods, Yahweh. So just pointing that out at the beginning, this is the first time we've encountered it in this school. So Yahweh gave to Israel all the land of which he had sworn to give their fathers. And they took possession of it and dwelt in it. The Lord gave them rest all around according to all that he had sworn to their fathers. And not a man of all their enemies stood against them. The Lord delivered all their enemies into their hand. Not a word failed of any good thing which the Lord had spoken to the house of Israel. All came to pass. Now it says it a lot of different ways for emphasis. But the point is made that there remained nothing more for God to do to fulfill the promises he made to their ancestors in terms of giving them the land. And that's what this book is about. It shows how that happened. And this is sort of the end of the book. This shows how this is what was accomplished. And it's very important. It's very important, of course, practically speaking, for the Jews, because, they needed a land. And calling them Jews at this point is anachronistic. They were called Israel. They weren't called Jews yet. Until after the Babylonian exile, they weren't called Jews. But sometimes it's a slip of the tongue I make. We should say Israel. Israel needed a homeland. This is the homeland that God picked for them. And one reason he picked that land was because it was already inhabited by people that God intended to get rid of. They were wicked people that had to be removed. And so I thought, well, this is a good land, flowing with milk and honey. Let's just give it to my people and get rid of the people who got to go anyway. But I would say it's also important, this passage is, for another reason, and that is that there is a theological controversy in our time as to whether God has ever really given Israel all the land that he promised. There are many people who say that there are yet unfulfilled promises that God has to fulfill to Israel in this respect. For example, if you look back at Joshua chapter 1, right at the beginning, when Joshua is called and commissioned here, it says in verses 3 and 4, "Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I said to Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon," this is the northern region, "as far as the great river, the river Euphrates." Now, most people consider that the river Euphrates is being referred to as the eastern boundary. "All the land of the Hittites and to the great sea," that'd be the Mediterranean, "toward the going down of the sun," meaning toward the west, "shall be your territory." So we've got three boundaries mentioned here. We've got the Lebanon wilderness to the north. We've got the Mediterranean on the west. And we've got the Euphrates River on the east. Now, in maps of Israel, you're not going to see the Euphrates River there. There is definitely a river on the eastern boundary of what's usually called Israel, but that's the Jordan River. If you want to see the Euphrates, you need a map that shows much more territory. And, of course, the nation of Israel has not generally been associated with the territory that far east. I mean, the Euphrates River, that's where Babylon was. This is like hundreds of miles east of Israel. And so because of this reference to the Euphrates as the eastern boundary, and it is also stated in Genesis when God speaks to the patriarchs about this, there are people who say, well, Israel never inhabited all that land, and therefore there must be a future time when God will fulfill that promise. Yet, interestingly, Joshua at the end of the book says God did give them all the land that he promised. Now, we either have to say they did inhabit the land all the way to the Euphrates, or that the promise was somehow conditional upon their obedience, and he gave them as much as their foot would tread on. He said, every place you set your foot, I've given it to you. That's the promise. Maybe they could have kept going to the Euphrates and said, this is the boundary I'll give to you. But if they didn't go that far, then the boundary changed to where they did put their feet, and they didn't maybe have such ambitions. It's hard to know exactly what to say about that. However, it is true that the Bible says elsewhere that Israel had holdings at the Euphrates, both David and Solomon. In 2 Samuel 8:3, speaking about David, chapter 8, verse 3, it says, David also defeated Hadadezer, the son of Rehob, king of Zobah, as he went to recover his territory at the river Euphrates. Now, he could be Hadadezer, but it's more likely it's David. I don't know why David would interfere with Hadadezer going, if it was Hadadezer trying to recover his territory at the Euphrates. That's far enough from Israel that David shouldn't be concerned about that. It sounds more like David was going to recover his territory at the Euphrates, and this man resisted him, and David defeated him, which would suggest that David not only recovered on this occasion that territory, but had had it before. You don't recover something unless you had it before and it was taken from you. So at some point prior to David's time, it would appear that David, and Israel's king, had holdings as far as the Euphrates River, which is, you know, agreeable with what the promise of God was. If you look at 1 Kings chapter 4, in verse 21, it says, "So Solomon," obviously the king of Israel after David, "reigned over all the kingdoms from the river to the land of the Philistines, as far as the border of Egypt. They brought tribute to and served Solomon." Now, the river, when spoken of that way without modification, is the Euphrates. And I think if you have a marginal reference, it should say so. Yeah, mine does. The Euphrates. Solomon reigned over all the kingdoms from the Euphrates to the east to the Philistines land, which is on the Mediterranean coast. So again, we have the east and the western boundaries mentioned. This time it doesn't talk about the northern, but it talks about the southern boundary, the river of Egypt. But if you look at the places where God promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob land, or even in Joshua chapter 1, where Joshua hears again, from this Lebanon to the river Euphrates, to to the great sea, toward going down to the sun. This is the land. The Euphrates is mentioned as the ultimate eastern boundary, and we read at least twice of Jewish kings ruling over that region. So for someone to say that Israel never possessed that land is, I think, going to have to go against what the Bible actually says specifically. Now, it's true that that region never was all called Israel, but God had delivered it to Israel. If they ruled over it, God had given it to them. They may not have ever incorporated it or annexed it as part of the country per se, but if they were all bringing tribute to them, then Israel essentially possessed it or ruled it. And so I don't think we have any problem with the statement that God fulfilled his entire promises to give Israel all the land that he promised them. Now, as with any book, the authorship is an issue, and the authorship of the book is not stated outright, although the implication is probably that Joshua is the author. That is certainly what the Jewish tradition says. The Jews believe he was the author. That doesn't make it right, because the Jews are just making their best guess too. But there's good reason for them to think so, because as all of you, I think, observed in your self-study questions, in chapter 24, verse 26, we know he wrote at least part of it. Near the end of the book, chapter 24, verse 26, it says, Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God, and he took a large stone, set it up, etc. Now, the book of the law of God was written by Moses, but Joshua apparently added to it. Now, these words, does this mean just the speech he had just given that's recorded in this chapter, or does this mean all the words that we've just read in the whole book? We don't know. But if he's the writer of the speeches, he might well be the writer of the history too. At least he's the best candidate. We know it was written in his lifetime, or at least very early in the period, because we are told in chapter 6 that Rahab, who was saved from Jericho at the time that Joshua led the first campaign there, it says she still lives with the children of Israel to this day. So the book was written during the lifetime of Rahab, which would be, of course, the earliest part of this period. So the author was writing within that generation, the same generation that Joshua was making these conquests, and so the timing is right for Joshua. We know he wrote part of it, and since he was Moses' successor, and Moses is the author of the previous works, there's at least it's reasonable to assume that he took over Moses' duties not only as the leader of the nation, but also as the chronicler of their activities. So we can't be 100% sure that Joshua is the author, but we can say it's somebody apparently contemporary with the situation. In fact, there's a really interesting textual variant at Joshua chapter 5, verse 2. Or maybe it's not 5:2. I may be having this wrong. I thought it was 5:2, but now I'm going to say I'm not sure. There's a reference there where maybe it's not 5. There's a reference where it actually says we did something, and it's in the narrative. It's not a speech. It's by any chance come across that? I thought it was 5:2. I looked at it earlier this morning, but maybe I'm remembering it wrong. It isn't. It isn't 5:2, so I'm afraid I can't tell you what it is. But
5:6.
Is it 5:6? Let me see. There is a textual variant where in the Hebrew it says we did such and such, but in the Septuagint and some of the other manuscripts it says they. See, most of the narrative when it talks about Israel says they did this and they did this and they marched here and they conquered here.
5:1 says we.
5:1, that's okay. I was just a verse off. Sorry about that. Thank you. That may be it. So it was when all the kings of the Amorites who were on this west side of the Jordan, and all the kings of the Canaanites who were by the sea heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan from before the children of Israel until we, should have been looking at verse 1, until we had crossed over. Now, this is not Joshua talking to people talking about we, this is the author describing, until we had crossed over. But the we there is found in the Hebrew text. It's they in some of the other manuscripts like the Septuagint. So it's not clear which it was originally. But if we is correct, then it was written by somebody who participated in, you know, crossing over the Jordan, either Joshua himself or somebody contemporary who would be writing under his supervision with his approval. So in any case, we can see Joshua's authority behind the book. It's his generation in which it was written, and he's as likely to be the one who wrote it as anyone else. Now, if Joshua wrote it, does he have the authority of a prophet? Well, he does prophesy. Actually, in his speeches at the end of the book, he says, "Thus saith the Lord," and he actually prophesies. He's also like Moses. Moses is the one who put his authority on Joshua, and Moses was certainly recognized as a prophet. And in chapter 27 of Numbers, you'll see how God described Joshua's role. Numbers chapter 27, verse 18 and following says, "Yahweh said to Moses, take Joshua, the son of Nun, with you, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay your hand on him. Set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation, and inaugurate him in their sight, and you shall give some of your authority to him, that all the congregation may become children of Israel, may be obedient. And he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall inquire before the Lord for him," and so forth. Now, we see that God selected Joshua to be take over the position Moses is in. Moses put his hand on him to signify transfer of authority to him. Now, Moses was authoritative to write scripture. He was a prophet. And therefore, Joshua, of course, would have authority of a similar sort, at least in the same category. So anything that Joshua wrote or that was written with his approval would be authoritative and therefore belong in the scriptures, as we say. Now, some parts of it were obviously written after he died, especially the last few verses. His own death is mentioned in chapter 24, verses 29 through 32. Jewish tradition says that Eleazar the priest wrote those verses. But then the death of Eleazar is also mentioned in the next verse, chapter 24, 33, and they say, well, Eleazar's son Phinehas wrote that. We don't know if that's true or not, but it doesn't really matter who wrote the death, so it's just the last three verses. It's like the end of Deuteronomy. It records the death of Moses. Somebody wrote that other than Moses. And it doesn't matter who it was. It's just a record of their death. It's not too concerned about the qualifications of the person who noted that he died. As we would know that anyway. Of course he died. Now, the man Joshua is the one who dominates this. Thomas Carlyle said that the history of the world is the biography of great men. And that's really interesting to think about, too. I mean, there's billions of people on the earth right now. But the history of this period will be remembered because of certain individuals who are prominent. The mistakes they make or the good things they do will be what historians will record and what later generations will read about our period of time. Certainly the history of Israel at its various times is really the biography of people like Moses and Joshua and various judges and David and so forth. Because although there were millions of Jews, the fate of all of them was kind of following like sheep after one particular leader that God raised up for them, and that's how the history progressed. So Joshua was the man of the hour. Joshua was the historic figure of his generation. He had first been seen way back in Exodus 17, apparently as a fairly young man, leading the children of Israel against the Amalekites, when they came out of Israel. The first people who attacked the Israelites when they came out of Israel in the wilderness were the Amalekites. They actually attacked them from the rear, trying to pick off the stragglers and the weak. Kind of a nasty way to do it. And so Moses went up on a hilltop with Aaron, his brother, and another man, Hur, who tradition says that was Miriam's husband, so brother-in-law. And Moses put his hands in the air and sent Joshua to lead the armies down to fight the Amalekites. And while Moses' hands were in the air, the Israelites prevailed against the Amalekites. And when Moses' hands grew weary and came down, the Amalekites tended to prevail. So Moses sat down on a rock, and Aaron and Hur stood on each side and held his hands up until the battle was over. And Joshua was the one who was the leader in that. We're given no earlier knowledge about Joshua before that, and we're not given any indication why he was selected as the one to lead the armies. But he was, and that's the first time we become aware of him. He's a hero. He's a military hero. And remember, he was born a slave. He was born in Egypt as a slave like the rest of them. He wasn't born a military man. He didn't have military training or military, probably never held a weapon. Slaves didn't have weapons. And they probably acquired their weapons from the dead Egyptians that washed ashore after the Red Sea closed up on them. And that was probably the first time he ever held a sword in his hand. And yet he became a warrior and a general and a leader. Obviously he was anointed by God for those particular roles and he was very successful in them. But his success was due to the prayer and the intercession of Moses on the mountaintop with his hands in the air. And so Joshua always recognized in his life that his military conquests were the result of God's blessing. He, at the end of his life, when he's giving his speeches, he talks to the Israelites to remind them of all that the Lord has done and all that the Lord has given them. He never mentions his own role in that. He doesn't say, you know, and I was your hero, you should remember me. You know, I should go down in history as the one who led you to victory. I was telling someone yesterday that as I read those words from Joshua not long ago, I was thinking about the contrast between him and Nebuchadnezzar, because Joshua did for Israel what Nebuchadnezzar did for Babylon. Took just a bunch of, not such a significant group people and turned them into a major world power. And Israel did become a world power eventually under David especially, but the founding of the nation, the new Babylon was founded under Nebuchadnezzar and the new Israel was founded under Joshua, and in both cases by exploits in war. Nebuchadnezzar was the general who led his armies and conquered the Assyrians and made the empire his. And in Daniel chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar's out looking at his conquest and says, this is the great Babylon that I have built. From a human standpoint, that was true. But then God struck him mad for 7 years till he would learn that the heavens reign and that God gives the nations to whomever he wills. Joshua knew that apparently instinctively. He could take as much credit for the establishing of Israel as Nebuchadnezzar could take for the establishing of Babylon. But he didn't try. He didn't want to. He always acknowledged that it was the Lord. He didn't even suggest that he was very humbled by his own role in the whole situation. And even his first victories over the Amalekites were due to the Lord, as is indicated by Moses' hands in the air in a position of petition and intercession. That's why when the hands were up, the battle went well. When the hands went down, the battle didn't go well, because as the prayers were slack, so was the deliverance. Now, he is later seen when Moses is going up on the mount to receive the law as the man who stayed close to Moses. Moses went alone up onto Mount Sinai and disappeared into a cloud, but Joshua went halfway up the mountain with him and camped there for 40 days and 40 nights, waiting for Moses to come down. Joshua then was isolated from the community just to be available when Moses would come down. He didn't know how long it would be. It was over a month. He sat there on the side of the mountain waiting for Moses to come down. And he served as Moses' personal servant or aide-de-camp, some would say. And his role with Moses is a lot like that which Elisha had with Elijah later on in the books of 1 and 2 Kings. Elijah was a great prophet like Moses was. And Elisha started out just being his servant. In fact, the way that Elisha was described by someone in his time was that he's the man who poured water over the hands of Elisha, over Elijah. He was like a servant to Elijah. But when Elijah went up into heaven, Elisha became his successor, and a double portion of Elijah's spirit came on him, and he continued as the successor to Elijah. Joshua was the same way. He started out just as the servant of Moses, but then ended up being, of course, his successor. In Exodus 24:13, he's referred to as Moses' servant. He was the man from Ephraim who was chosen to go with the other spies, one from each of the tribes, to spy out the land of Canaan 40 years before this. And while 10 of the 12 spies brought back a discouraging report that turned the people's faith away from God and brought judgment on the nation, only he, the Ephraimite, and Caleb, the Judahite, they were the only two spies that came back after the scouting mission and reported that though there was a challenge, they could do it through faith in God. He was a man who had faith in God, but the whole nation did not. I mean, when you've got 3 million people who have reason to have faith in God because they've seen the Dead Sea, I mean, the Red Sea part, and they've walked through and they've seen miraculous manna day by day. I mean, these are people who have reason to be believers. And yet, out of 3 million people who should be believers, only three guys really are believers, Moses and Joshua and Caleb. You have to be a pretty exceptional person to have faith at a time when no one else does. And he was one of those guys, which is no doubt why he was selected to be the successor to Moses. And we read in Numbers 27 how that happened. And so, at the beginning of Joshua, God says to Joshua, as I was with Moses, I'll be with you. And so he is now the leader in Moses' shoes and has that authority. The people needed to know who was going to succeed Moses, and that's why the laying on of hands was important. It was like a visible ceremony that Moses was authorizing him, and that when Moses was dead, there wouldn't be a power vacuum. As I mentioned before, in our introduction to history books, what's strange is that Joshua didn't do the same thing when he died. He didn't appoint a successor, and there was a power vacuum. But apparently, God didn't think there was need for one, for a leader to succeed him. Once the wars were essentially over, there would be no need for a military leader or political leader again until there was a trouble. And the trouble wouldn't have come if they didn't depart from God. In the book of Judges, they were invaded again and needed to fight more wars, but that's only because they rebelled. If they hadn't rebelled, God would have kept them safe and they could have had a peaceful life. They wouldn't need rulers or local overseers of the congregation. They didn't become new apostles when the apostles died. There was not another generation of apostles that were appointed after that. And so there is some parallel there, but it doesn't necessarily support the idea of the institutional church that we need to have institutional authority, successors to the apostles living today necessarily. Now, the historical setting, I didn't mention this. Joshua, you'll find that he's mentioned by more than one name in the Bible, as several characters are, but he has more names than most. He is mentioned in Numbers chapter 13, verses 8 and 16, as Oshea. And then Moses gave him the longer name Jehoshua. Now Jehoshua means, is taken from the name Yahweh or Jehovah. And Shua, Shua means salvation in Hebrew, and Jehovah means Jehovah. And so the name Jehoshua means Jehovah is salvation. Joshua, or Yeshua, a probably more authentic pronunciation, is a shortened form of Jehoshua, just kind of abbreviating it, like we abbreviate some of our names to make them shorter to mention people without so many syllables. So Jehoshua was his name, as Moses gave to him, but he went more often by Joshua. He's sometimes called Hoshea, which is like Oshea. In Deuteronomy 32:44, he's called Hoshea. And, of course, you probably knew this, but some may not, is that the Greek form of Joshua or Yeshua is Jesus or Jesus. Now, I'll just say this because there are false statements about this name Jesus going around. Unfortunately, there's a growing movement that's trying to get everyone to use the authentic Hebrew pronunciation of everything. And they're saying that it's actually sacrilegious to use the name Jesus, because they say in the Greek, Jesus is Jesus, and they say it's based on the word Zeus. They say Jesus means praise Zeus. Well, it would be very wise for people to do a little research before they pronounce the meaning of words. Because it's absolutely incorrect. Jesus has nothing to do with the word Zeus. The etymology is not connected in any way with the name Zeus. Jesus is the Greek transliteration of Yeshua. The Greek language has no SH sound, so they simply use the S. So it's not Yeshu, but it's Yesu. Jesus, the ending of the word is irrelevant. But Jesus is the transliteration of Yeshua. Yeshua is the Hebrew for Joshua. And so in the New Testament, Jesus is in Greek called Jesus. Jesus is simply the anglicized form of that name. So, you know, you hear all kinds of stuff from people who act authoritative, and they just don't ever, in many cases, know what they're talking about. So the name Jesus is quite a legitimate name to use. It's the English form of Jesus. If Jesus was not okay, then why did the apostles use it when they wrote the New Testament? I mean, every reference to Jesus by name in the New Testament uses the word Jesus, and it was written by the apostles, so there can't be anything wrong with using that name. But it is the same name as Joshua. It's just in another language. And so Jesus is named Joshua. And it's interesting, too, because in a sense, Joshua is a type of Christ. And his function in the story has many ways in which he is a type of Christ. I said that Moses is a type of Christ. And in relation to Moses, Joshua is a little bit like the apostles, the successors. But seen in another framework, Joshua in his own right has some role as a type of Christ. Now, I've been used the word type a few times. Again, I hope you know these words. They're not really unusual words. Christians use them all the time, but I have to realize that some people may not know what we mean by a type of Christ. This is a term theologians use, but they got it right from the Bible. The word is used in the Bible, a type. It's the Greek word tupos. You might spell it T-U-P-O-S. The second letter in that, in the Greek, is the upsilon, which can be represented by the English Y or the English U, as in the word psuche, which we would render as psyche. The upsilon could be a U or a Y when you transliterate it. So tupos could be typos. And the word tupos is used in the New Testament, for example, of Adam is a type or tupos of Christ, according to Romans 5:12. The wandering of the Israelites in the wilderness and their experiences are said to be a type of us, tupos in the Greek, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6, and also verse 11. Twice, the Israelite experience is a type of us, it says. Now, what the word tupos means is a pattern. And when we speak of something in the Old Testament being a type of something in the New Testament, we mean that the Old Testament, it sort of prefigures it. The thing in the Old Testament is a pattern for something that's more important that's coming up later in the New Testament. And so the sacrifices in the Old Testament are types of Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Paul says that Adam is a type of Christ in the sense that both of them are the founders of new humanities. Adam was the founder of the original humanity, and a new humanity or new man was founded in Christ, and so forth. When Abraham offered his son Isaac on the altar, we usually say that's sort of a type of God the Father offering Christ, and there's some reason to think so. Lots of things in the Old Testament are said to be types of things in the New Testament. And so when we say Joshua is a type of Christ, we mean in his role as the leader of the children of Israel. It's like Israel is a type of us. And Joshua himself is a type of our leader, Christ. And there are ways that that can be pointed out to be significant in helping us understand certain Christian ideas as we look at the typology of the Old Testament. So from now on, you'll know what I mean when I say a type. You probably already did, but some might not have. Now, the historical setting, we would date the entering of Canaan at the very beginning of the book of Joshua in the year 1451. Or 1452. Different scholars calculate it differently, but in the little yellow box I've given here, I tell you how I calculated it, and it's not original with me, others have done so. We know that Judah fell to Babylon in 586 BC. Now, from that starting point, we can calculate other dates. We know from secular history that Judah fell to Babylon in 586 BC. So starting from that date, we are told in Ezekiel 4, verses 4 through 5, that the history of the kings of Judah, which is from the splitting of the kingdom in Rehoboam's day to the fall of Babylon, is 390 years. Now, if you lose me here, that's okay. But, I mean, this is mathematical stuff. If it's 390 years from Rehoboam's reign, when the kingdom split, to the fall in 586 B.C., that means that the kingdom split at the beginning of Rehoboam's reign in 975 B.C. That's just simple math. But before that was Solomon's reign, which was 40 years, and before that was David's reign. That was 40 years. And the thing is, though, that Solomon's reign would have begun in 1015 by this reckoning. The kingdom split in, what, 975. That was at the end of a 40-year reign of Solomon. Solomon then began to reign in 1015 BC. But the temple was built in the third year of King Solomon, which would be, of course, 1012 BC.
Fourth year, right?
Does it say the fourth year? I thought it was the third year. I'll go with you. I'll go with you on that. Maybe it's the fourth year. But the way it was calculated, as I saw it, it was 1012 BC.
No, it's the First Kings 6:1 is in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel.
Okay.
In the month Ziph, in the second month.
Second month. So, in other words, 3 years had passed.
3 years had passed.
Right.
Yes,
exactly.
But
yeah,
it was
okay.
Actually the fourth
right.
year.
Okay. We're calculating 3 years space of time. It was in the second month of the fourth year, which means it was just after the end of 3 years. That's what I meant when I meant we go from the year 1015 to the year 1012. BC. So the temple was built in 1012 BC by that reckoning, and we are told in 1 Kings 6:1 that was 480 years after the Exodus. So we have these time markers at various places scattered around, but enough of them to figure it out. The temple was built in 1012 BC, and that was 480 years after the Exodus, so that brings us back to about 1451, that general time for the entering to Canaan.
Again, it was actually in the 480th year, so it had just been 479.
Okay.
That's what's really tricky about doing biblical chronology.
Yeah, that's why I'm putting a slash here. The slash here, 1452 or 1451, because it is true, sometimes it says it's in the something year, and depending on what month it is, it might be closer to the smaller number than the large number. Anyway, so I'm not too concerned about nailing down the exact year. We can see that it's about 1450 approximately years before Christ that this entrance into Canaan took place. Now, the time covered in the book is thought by most to be about 25 years. That can't be proven beyond question, but Josephus, the Jewish historian, believed that Joshua was 85 when he entered the land of Canaan. And that is possibly true. That would have made him 45 when they came out of Egypt. And this is 40 years later. So he led these armies when he was 85 years old. He lived to be 110, though. And he's 110 at the end of the book. So if he's 85 at the beginning, which is somewhat speculative because there's nothing in the Bible that tells us he was 85 at that time, but that's what Josephus said, and it's a realistic number we can take as a default until we know otherwise, then that would mean 25 years are occupied by the book, of which the first six or so are used conquering the land, and then there's a long gap until the end of Joshua's life, and so we got a total of about probably 25 years covered in the book. That is not something that could not be disputed. It could be disputed. We know this, that at the beginning, it's the second generation after the Exodus. There's no one still living except Joshua and Caleb, who was over 20 years old at the time of the Exodus. The oldest people living at this time who had been, the oldest people at this time, how do we work this out? Everyone who was 20 and under 40 years earlier was now dead. So everyone was under 60. Let's put it that way, right? No one was over 60 except Joshua and Caleb. That's the way. It's a young population, in other words. I mean, 60 is really young. I'm 58. I'm not old. But think of it, a nation where the oldest people alive are 60 years old or less, except for two guys, Joshua and Caleb, who are in their 80s. And so this is the demographic we're looking at. We know Moses had left Joshua in command, and 40 years earlier when Joshua had come back with the report that, yeah, we can take this land, I don't think he knew that someone was going to hand him the keys and say, okay, do it, you're the guy. You think we can do it? You got the faith? You're the man. You lead them against these giants. And so at this point, we see that Joshua has to put his works where his faith is, and put money where his mouth is. And so he does. And he does it a good job. He's a real hero. To my mind, he's never been as colorful or prominent, of course, as someone like Moses or David. But in many respects, he's just as important. I mean, Moses, of course, is the most important man in the Old Testament, but what Joshua accomplished was as great in many respects, and certainly extremely important, because entering the land was the way that the ultimate fulfillment of God's promises would take place, and it was the biggest challenge. Moses didn't have to lead them against, you know, these nations of the Canaanites and fight them, so he just had to put up with them in the wilderness, which was a challenge enough, I'm sure. Now, the outline of the book, the main divisions of the book are right down the middle. The first 12 chapters are the period of the conquest of the land, and the last 12 are the time of them being occupying, they've received their inheritance, they're occupying the land. Now, these two sections themselves can be divided into smaller bits, because the first 5 chapters really are a description of them entering the land and preparing to go to war. And chapters 6 through 12 are them actually fighting those wars, actually conquering the land itself. Then after that, chapters 13 through 22, perhaps the most difficult chapters to wade through because of the nature of their contents, is simply a description of how the land was divvied up among the different tribes. Primarily, it's just the division of the land. And then the last chapters, 23 and 24, are the farewell addresses of Joshua. And so that's how the book is most naturally divided into smaller parts. Now, why is that important? It's not the most important thing in the world, but it's helpful when you take a book that's rather large-ish to divide it into smaller parts so you can take it piece by piece. You can just get more of a handle on the book. It's not quite so daunting if you have something that you're looking at 24 chapters and it's just all a blur. It helps to say, well, this little section's about this, little section about that. It makes it more manageable and helpful, I think. Now, let's talk about the biggest issue that most people have with it, and that is genocide. First question we have to ask, because it comes up a lot these days with the prominence of terrorism and, you know, Islamic radicals and so forth, is many times people say, well, you know, sure, it's wrong for the jihadists to kill innocent populations, but isn't that just the same thing that God had the Jews do in the Old Testament? What's the difference? If the Muslims think that God is telling them to go out and kill the infidels, didn't God of the Jews and God of the Christians tell the Israelites to go and kill the infidels too? I mean, how is that any different? And they were killing men, women, and children? Well, there are some differences. That doesn't make it altogether unobjectionable to us, to our sensitivities, but there are definitely differences. For one thing, the jihad is the struggle of Islam to convert the world. And in the early days, in Muhammad's day, when, for example, he conquered Mecca and so forth, he had to fight wars against people to convert them. The idea of the jihad is, if you convert, we'll keep you around. If you don't, you'll die. So that basically it's conversion on the threat of death. And if you refuse to convert, we'll kill you. Nothing like that ever existed in the Old Testament. First of all, God wasn't offering the Canaanites the option of conversion. He wasn't trying to convert them. It was a judgment on a society that was doomed because of its wickedness to be destroyed. It looks like jihad to somebody who's not discerning the different reasons, but they're not trying to convert these people. They're seeking to eradicate them from the face of the earth. And it's not because they're not Jewish, because the world was full of non-Jewish people that God never sent the Jews to go and fight. It's not that God's saying everyone has to become Jewish or die. It's that the Canaanites had to be judged, period. They were a society under God's judgment, just like Sodom and Gomorrah were at an earlier period of time, or the whole world was in the time of Noah. God judged the whole world at one time. He judged whole cities at other times. In this case, he judged the whole society of the Canaanites because of their horrible wickedness. And that being so, it's not really at all like going out and using war to convert people. Furthermore, they weren't sent out against all the pagans. It's not like Israel had a mission to go out and convert the Babylonians and the Syrians and the Edomites and the Egyptians, and, you know, if they don't convert, kill them. They weren't even sent to make war with them. It was not God's intention to go out and convert everyone to Judaism. It was his intention to give the Jews a piece of land that it was inhabited by some people who had to go. And that's really all it was. It still is a ugly situation, but it's not a similar situation to jihad. Another thing is, we know that God is not bloodthirsty. The Bible makes that very clear. He reveals his character to Moses on the mountain in chapter 34 of Exodus in a way that we still recognize in the New Testament as an accurate description of the way that God is. In chapter 34 of Exodus, verses 6 and 7, it says, "The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, Yahweh, Yahweh Elohim, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation." Now here God is described as long-suffering, that means patient, merciful, gracious, abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands of generations, but also a God who punishes wickedness. And that's the character of God. That's the way justice is. But he doesn't have any delight in the punitive side of his activities. In Ezekiel 33:11, God says he has no pleasure in the death of the wicked. And so it's not like he's bloodthirsty and just hates people, and, you know, if anyone just bugs him, he just wants to go smear their blood all over the land so that they learn a lesson. He has to judge wickedness, and he does. And the Canaanites were very wicked, and we'll see more about that later on.